Hello and welcome to my talk about Git fixes. I'm Jörg Rödel. You might know me from the annoying emails you get every week. In this talk, I will tell you how the emails are generated, which is only material for about 20 minutes. So we have plenty of time to have discussions. And so when you have some questions or concerns or something, just raise your hand and we can discuss it right away during the talk. So let's get started. First of all, with some history. So the Git fixes tool was written by me in 2016, and I announced it here at Labs conference in a talk. Back then, we agreed to have an infrastructure that sends out regular emails to everyone with potential fixes for people to check and to backport to our kernel branches. Initially, this only split the patches up between patches that are sent to individual developers and patches that are for base kernel for the base kernel commits. And the emails were sent weekly, of course. So this was what we agreed on. And a little while after we started with that, there came the branch maintainers along and told me that this would be great to have incremental daily updates of that. So if it comes a super important fix, that we don't have to wait a week until we finally notice it and have and can backport it. So this is how the daily incremental updates came to be. All of this worked out quite well for the developer fixes that are sent to the individual developers, but it didn't get us any real traction into the base kernel fixes. So this was only sent, they were only sent to mailing lists, and not enough people actually cared about them. So I thought a bit about how we can improve on that, and my first approach was implementing a heuristic based on a tool I wrote named Git Who, which tries to find out the most likely person that can make changes to a given source code file based on previous contributions to our kernels. This didn't work out very well, so recently I added the maintainers file-based approach. I compiled a big maintainers file for our kernels out of the wiki page and updated it with all of your input. And this is how the maintainers emails came to be. So how have you been doing with backporting the fixes? Some numbers for three selected branches. I think the best here is Sleeve 15, where we have backported or blacklisted around 80% of the fixes that have been reported. Sleeve 12 SP3 is somewhere in the middle, and Sleeve 11 SP4 didn't get that much traction. Yeah, can only speculate why, but yeah. And on the bottom, you can see the average time it takes for a patch to be backported. No, not from a patch to be added to the. The time it takes from a patch that when it is added to the list until it actually appears into the branch. So given that emails are sent out weekly for base kernel updates, so there is a base delay of say 1 or 2 weeks at least. So now, how does the process work of generating these emails you get every week or potentially every day? So from a high-level view, we have kernel-source.git and we have linux.git. Kernel-source.git contains our kernel branches, and linux.git is the upstream tree. And this is the input for the Git fixes tracking. The Git fixes tracking generates lists of potential fixes for every kernel branch. And these lists are used as input for the email generation tool. The email generation tool sends out the emails to everyone and to the mailing lists. And then the developers come into the game and backport the fixes or blacklist them or whatever. And when they are backported, they get into kernel-source.git. The Git fixes tracking notices it and updates everything. And they disappear from the next email, and the circle starts again. So let's get a bit into the details. How does the Git fixes tracking work? So first of all, we need a list of commits that are contained in a given kernel branch. So a given kernel branch consists of a base kernel. For 3.15, this would be 4.12. So we need a list of all commits that are in 4.12 that can easily be generated with the command, with the git command you see there. You also see the format in which this list is expected. So the full hash separated by a comma by the context. Context is usually the potential developer that can backport or that should backport the fix. Or for base kernel fixes, it's just base. With that base list, we take the git SUSE tool, which extracts all commit IDs which are in a given kernel branch by just looking into the serious.conf file, opening every patch there, and reads out the commit ID and looks for signed off by and act by text with a SUSE related domain. So every SUSE domain on novel.com, that is. And adds these patches to this list, and this is one of the inputs for the git fixes tool. What the git SUSE tool also does is generating the blacklist, generating a list of blacklisted commits and blacklisted paths. So we just see what this is good for. So here's a diagram of how this happens. So we generate the commit list, the blacklisted commits and blacklisted paths, and the git fixes on will find the fixes. For that, it iterates over the linux.git history and looks for fixes tags in the commits it, in the commit messages it finds there. And if any commit messages contains a fixes tag with the commit ID that we have in one of our branches, then this fix is considered is added to a list. If it's not blacklisted, so if it's not on the blacklisted list, and if the patch does not only touch blacklisted paths, so if we have a patch, for example, that touches only, say, Arch Blackfin or something, which we don't care about, then the patch is not considered. So this is the first filtering that happens. And this is done by the git fixes tool. And the output of that is a fixes list. And this fixes list exists for every branch that we track. I think this is our 4 at the moment. And that is used as the input for the email generation tool, which uses a pretty simple process. So this is implemented in, I think, around 1,000 lines of code. C++ code. So, yeah, let's go through this. So, first of all, the tool it does not work per branch. It works over all branches. It takes as input the fixes list for all branches we care about. So, then these patches are read in and taken into the, and then the first assignment step comes. The first assignment step groups the patches together. So if a fix appears in multiple fixes lists, it is just tracked once, and we track in which branches it is needed. So in the emails you see commit hash subject needed in the branches, and this is how this comes to be. Then the fixes are split up to fixes that are directly assigned to individual developers, because it's a fix for a patch we backported, or into base kernel fixes, because they are fixes that are for commits that are already in our base kernel. So for the developer fixes, the thing continues pretty easy. It goes through the it goes into a database where I record the commits that have been reported to every developer. The simple reason is that I can look which commits have been added for an individual developer and which have been removed. And out of that information, I can create the incremental reports. And I also always create the full report, and the full report gets the full list of current fixes for an individual developer. The base kernel fixes thing is a bit more complicated. So first of all, we do the maintainers matching. This is a new feature. Every fix, Every potential fix that matches a maintainer entry or multiple maintainer entries. It is only assigned to one maintainer entry in the end, but if it matches, is removed from the internal base kernel fixes list and assigned to and appears into the report for that maintainer's entry. So there will be then, if there are fixes, there is one report for every maintainer entry. So the rest of the fixes are put into the base kernel reports that are sent to our internal mailing list. And we still do this git hool matching, the heuristic I talked about on the remaining patches, but I think most people should not see this anymore in their emails, because most patches are actually catched now by the maintainer's file. I think the fixes list shrunk from 600 to 900 emails patches down to below 100 per branch after the maintainer's matching was implemented. So in the end, we have four kinds of reports. We have the incremental reports, the full reports, the maintainer reports, and the base kernel reports. And these are all sent via a small Python script to the individual people. This happens via a cron job. So the cron job for the incremental reports is executed every day, obviously, and for the other three reports, it's executed once per week on Monday. If it works, yeah, I was on leave in the past week and noticed that no reports were sent out today because of some issue on ConZ4S. That's why you received emails today. So, yeah. So, this is how the emails come into existence. And now I want to present my to-do list for Git fixes. Yep. It's in actually my home directory. The question was where the database and all the state is hosted, and it's hosted in my home directory in NFS. Yeah, it's the tracking fixes directory. I don't know if it's publicly readable, but yeah. So to do what is on my to-do list when I get to it. First of all, is better detection of upstream reverts. I already have detection in the git fixes tool for reverts, but the reverts are only matched against potential fixes. So when I found a commit that has a fixes tag and have it on the list, and that I find the revert, I remove that patch from the fixes list. But I don't yet check if there's a revert for a commit that is already in our tree. So this needs to be implemented. Another concern that has been raised by multiple people already was that the patches are sorted by commit ID when they appear in the emails. This comes from the data structure being used when they are tracked in the tools. So it's it's basically a C++ map. So when I output them, they are sorted by design. So the request is to sort them into the tuple order, so in the order in which they appeared in Linus tree. And I need to add some tracking for that and sorting to make the output correct. The next thing I want to implement is to actually read commit IDs not only from the commit ID tag we have in our patches, but also from cherry pick lines. So when you have a line like commit SHA-1 upstream, then I would also like to read the commit ID from that line. This recently came to my attention when I looked into our SSBD and LDL1 TF backports, which didn't have the correct upstream commit IDs in them, just because we didn't backport the upstream commits directly, but just backported the patches that are already in some stable tree. So I think Takashi fixed that meanwhile, so that the patches now have the correct commit ID tag. But I think it would be good to just handle that and also read commit IDs from cherry pick lines. So, and then there are also some wild ideas I have. Maybe you can give me some input on it or what do you think about it. maybe some automatic bacilla creation per. Yep, that's a question.
It's a comment rather than a question. It's on the semi-automatic backporting. By and large, I'm strongly supportive of the Git fixes thing. I think it does an excellent job. But the semi-automatic backporting, I fear, would fall into the same problem that also Cell fell into with the stable one. And I don't want to see you turned into the Susie Sasha. and just as a word of warning, as it says, oh, maybe it'd be fine. There's at least one Git fix, for example, and it's portrayed as a performance fix for Get User Pages. But the version of Sleeves reported to, the fixes commit was slightly wrong, and it actually fixed another patch entirely. And that patch wasn't backported, and it was that patch that introduced the performance problem in the first place. But if you applied to the patch, it would apply. But then the machine would proceed, it would go down and have stability issues, and it would be very, very subtle. And when I looked at it, I knew which patch that was, and then I looked and I saw that the fixes was wrong, and I knew it was safe to blacklist because we were not affected by the problem. But a semi-automatic back, it was clean, applied no fuzz, no offsets, looked beautiful. But it was a wreck, or would have been a wreck if it was applied. So I'm not very supportive of the semi-automatic backporting at all, even though my own Git list fixes list is ridiculous because apparently I maintain SE Linux, RCU.
Yeah, okay. What I meant by semi-automatic backporting is just doing checks whether patches apply cleanly and whether the resulting kernel has any KVI changes, something like that, not making the decision automatic of whether it needs to be backported or not. Yeah.
That's one example. I'm sure there's another one. And the first time it happens, it's somehow your fault.
Yeah, we.
I don't think that's fair.
It's out of question that a developer has to look at every patch before it's actually committed to our tree. So that's not something I'm planning to replace.
Another thing is, can we strip down the list of CCs? Because it's nice that you send mails out that patches for HARE at SUSE.com. Okay, fine. Patches for J Thompson at SUSE.com. Okay, maybe. Patches for GG Slabby at SUSE.com. Patches for Jessica Yu at SUSE.com. Why am I getting those?
Is Do you get them directly into your inbox or no?
Yeah. Well, it's a bit pointless. So why, as you already know, these are the patches which are supposed to be handled by that and that person. So yeah, I mean, no, but I'll put it the other way around. What are we supposed to get? Which information are we supposed to get from this mail?
I think the mails to the individual developers are only sent to the developer itself and to the current CVS mailing list, right?
Yeah, which means everyone's getting it because there has been
a branch maintainer request to do this, so I didn't care and edit it because it's just a...
Maybe it's just me and I just need to forward it to DevNode, but it's
just
still
a
stupid.
Drop list because it's getting so much mail anyway and it's more or less a log of...
Yeah, exactly. And that's so the information I get from this might be useful if it's some of my team. All right, granted. But anyone not in my team...
It's more for recording the history of fixes reporting, so it's not anything you should take... Anything you need to take attention.
Definitely.
If you want to strip down the CC list on the maintainers entries, just tell me and I can remove people from entries. Or
no, the maintainers are fine. It's just the program for the individual developers. Mm-hmm. Or no, these are for the individual developers and not for the.
And also, if developers leave, I usually add a redirect for that email address to kernel@suse.de until someone else volunteers to handle these fixes.
How can we do this? How can we map all stale persons to real persons? Is there an entry somewhere which we can edit?
It's somewhere where I can edit, so you have to send me an email.
Right.
It's actually implemented in the mail files Py file.
Also, can we have a sub-entry for InfiniBand?
Sure.
Okay.
Just send
Consider yourself mailed.
Just send me an entry and I can edit to the file.
Okay.
Yeah, what about the automatic bacilla creation and updating so we can automatically track or we can automatically create bacillas for fixes and automatically closing them when fixes are removed from the list, or?
I don't
some of them are creating one Godzilla and Creator pile of patches that are somehow related or just pile of patches to backport. Some people are basically doing one block per missing patch. I'm not really sure we want to have something automatic in the trigger. I really appreciate Jess script to basically create a bug for me. That's an improvement. I'm not really sure that something automatic would help. I don't know.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, so, okay. So this is what I have on my list, and now we come to the wish list. So that's the part where I want to know from you what you think, what works well, what does not in the process, what else besides from the things I already mentioned do you like to see improved, and yeah, or if you have any other ideas, wild ideas. So yeah, feel free to raise your hand and speak up. Yes, yeah.
Okay. Well, I quite don't agree with Michel on the last thing he said. Personally, I would appreciate a lot to have bugs created for me. I actually mailed about it several months ago. I did not really get an answer, and as a result, your mails to me did not get an answer either.
Sorry, I can't. It's not loud enough. I can't hear you.
Okay. Better?
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay. Sorry. So I was saying what Michel said, that he does not want mails to be created, bugs to be created. My opinion is opposite. I would like to have bugs created because it does motivate me to look into the mails you send to me. I started working on the backports long ago, then realized that I could not commit them because I had no bug ID associated with them. And just gave up at that point, wrote a mail to the mailing list, which did not get an answer, or at least not an answer I liked. I made no progress since then. I'm certain that with bug created and assigned to me, I would look into this issue and it would be solved already. I don't know if, see, this is just me maybe, I don't know if it would be a big problem to make this a pair developer setting. Just an idea, maybe a list of developers who do want bugs to be created for them, and then for these guys, you do that. Just an idea.
You could compromise on this one, and if you did have something that automatically creates the Bugzillas, merge that into the kernel source scripts directory instead of incorporating it directly into Git fixes. And when you run it, you give it an ID of a commit ID as identified here too, and it creates the email. Then it'll be a developer choice. If they want to take Michael's approach and do their own Bugzilla, work away. And if you want the standard one that creates a subject as missing Git fixes, whatever that you would prefer, then you run it. And that becomes a personal choice. It's just the location of when that happens. So I'd say there's support for the tool because some want it, but just provide it for them to run, and it only takes one parameter, Git, I think.
Yeah, so there's already Jeff's tool, so you can just build your process around that and or build your own scripts around that and build that on your own, yeah?
Yeah, okay, I must say for myself, I definitely don't want auto-created bugs, so if some people want, why not? But it has to be optional. Yeah, there were weeks where I had like 30 new patches from Git fixes just in a week, and I don't really want to have 30 open bugs because it would clutter all Bugzilla searches for active bugs and whatever.
Yeah, that's a valid point, right?
You have to do the patch backporting and then close all the bugs as well.
So the same compromise still works. Put something at the kernel source. Because then when you're dealing with it, even if you like to have them automatically created, you create them one at a time as according as you're doing the backport, so you don't make a mess of your Bugzilla queue. The same compromise applies.
Right, yeah.
interface to the system where you might, you know, just have a link that someone can click on or two queries, but so you can
A dashboard, yeah. No, there's no web page existing at the moment. Probably.
What does it have to be automatically in the canvas source repository? So we already do have script for creating particular entries for commits. In the
kernel
source repository.
Sure. The compromise would be a small. The compromise would be a small wrapper around it, so the format of those git things and emails would be identical. That the subject would be instantly recognizable.
While there is a tool for automatically creating Bugzilla entries, the intent would be that it would be precise. It would be consistently formatted. So it would probably just be a 3 or 4 liner around that. That's that around the Bugzilla creation tool, but the subject would always be consistent, the component would be consistent, the format of the summary would be consistent, and it wouldn't be Mel's get fixes Bugzilla format, Michael's, Bob's, whoever. Basically, we've talked way too long about this already. It's a 5 or 6 long shell script that gets put into kernel source scripts. We're going well into bike shed territory.
On a completely different note, what about stable patches? There are stable patches which are not marked as fixes. Do we get them too?
No, but Takashi...
Should we maybe do this?
Yeah, right. I talked to Takashi about this week, and what he uses as input for his Easter eggs webpage and emails as usual is the input from git fixes and from stable trees.
So can't you just interrupt it in your git fixes stuff?
The difficulty is to pick the right stable tree per branch or per base kernel we have, but yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But that can be solved, I think, so.
So it would be really beneficial if we could just make this automatic, because I already had some, well, rather anxious questions from IBM. How do we handle stable backports now that we don't have stable anymore?
Yeah, I put that on the list with a bit higher priority, so. Other concerns, suggestions, ideas? Yeah.
I have something very trivial. Currently, the maintainer's mail is sorted by patch, and then for each patch, it says which version it should go to. And if you could do that, could you include another list which kind of reverses that? So I see, like, this version takes this and this and this patch, and that version takes that and that patch, because that's the way how it works. It's a minor improvement.
Yeah, that's how it initially worked, but... There have been concerns by people that patches appear in multiple sections then, and yeah, it's...
Because right now I have to go through the list manually, and if it's reversed, I could just go one by one, and that's how I work.
Yeah, what I usually do is I save my email as a text file and then go through and delete the branch line from the fix, and if there's no branch line left, I can remove the fix from the file and... Do it this way, so. Anything else? No, then thanks for your suggestions and for listening, and yeah, have a nice rest of the conference.